multiple award-winning journalist Phyllis Thomas has seen firsthand the challenges and the rewards of navigating Jamaica's complex journalistic landscape. She joins us now to share a few insider tips for aspiring journalists. So it's really, really great to have her. Morning, Phyllis. Welcome.
Good morning, Delia. Good to be here. Good to see you again.
So listen, you were at the Gleaner as a journalist for 45 years.
45 years, Delia. Can you imagine that?
Wow.
45
There must
years.
Be a kind of love that's different to being in a job for 45 years.
Yes, yes, you know. In fact, I enjoy, you know, there's ups and downs, but I just enjoy working out there for the people, mm-hmm. for the people, bringing the news to the people.
Yeah.
And when the news is breaking, I'm in the center, I get this adrenaline rush.
Wow.
To be out there.
What sparked your interest in pursuing a career in journalism, Phyllis?
You know, I think it's the Lord. I had no interest in being a journalist.
Really?
I wanted to be a doctor, passionate about medicine, passionate about, I wanted to be a surgeon, as a matter of fact,
Whoa.
To be in the person. Mm-hmm. I remember when I was doing my zoology and I had to do the practical at U itself. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the interview, at the end of the examination, we went inside the what you call anatomy department. And I was inside of a dead person looking at the organs.
Wow.
I was just so fascinated. I wanted to be a doctor.
Then how did you end up in journalism?
Okay, now, so because I'm from a poor family, right?
Okay.
And my parents could not afford to send me further. So I had to go out there and find a job.
Oh.
And then I saw this advertisement in the Gleaner to come in and, you know, they were advertising for reporters.
Yeah.
Three new reporters for the Star. I did the interview and that's how I became successful.
Wow.
And I stayed there. In fact, when I went to the Gleaner, it was just, I was just passing through.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave myself just a couple of, I said probably about a year
mm-hmm.
to get the
get
subjects that I
need,
yes, and the subject that I need to matriculate university
mm-hmm.
into medical school. But then the other thing they call a journalism bug,
mm-hmm.
it bit me.
Yeah.
And so I
also think purpose is an incredible
yes,
thing.
Yes.
Because maybe if you talk to your parents, I'm gonna say, Phyllis had that inquiring mind.
Mm-hmm. But even apart from that, you know, the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord played a role because I'm saying medicine, he said journalism. This is where I want you to be.
Correct.
And you know what, Delia? I didn't realize that until way late.
Mm-hmm.
That's really the Lord was behind this.
Yeah.
And he's good, he's awesome, and he has been with me throughout the entire time.
Excellent, excellent.
So to God be the glory.
To God be the glory. So when you started, no formal training in journalism,
no.
But you did eventually go
yes,
to university.
Yeah. But when we started at Gleaner, they used to bring in the trainers from the region, and so we got some solid training in how to use words.
Mm-hmm.
English, we use the words, we make the words talk,
wow.
we make the words sing,
wow.
and we use words, it's just like an art, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But after that, no, I went to the university when I decided that, you know, this is it.
Yeah.
I'm going to formalize it. And so I went to the university, I did Caremark, and so I left university with a first class honors.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, so beautiful. I think a lot of people, Phyllis, among the stories they'll remember you for is you going undercover in the free zone.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, talk to me. How did that come about?
Okay, so my son's father had this, his friend, and his friend's wife worked there, and they were always complaining. They have back aches, and they were treated badly by these persons who were operating the free zone. You know, at that time, I think it was Edward Siaga who was the prime minister,
mm-hmm.
and the free zone was lucrative.
Yes.
The apparel sector was lucrative, and so you had persons, you had the companies from the United States, and they would outsource their garments to be completed here in Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
But then I could sew. That's one of the things that I did at school.
Wow.
And so, in fact, when I was at work, I was making even my jeans.
Because me, I said to myself, how Phyllis get the work? No, you have to can't sew for get the work.
Of course.
Okay.
I sewed everything. I consider myself a fashionista. Still do. Because I love clothes.
Yes.
I love to look good.
Yes.
And so I sew. And so my son's father said to me, why don't you go in the free zone and see what is happening? I'm going to say, what?
Mm.
Seriously?
Mm.
He said, yeah, you can do it because you can sew. Just go.
Mm-hmm.
Because prior to going in there, we were trying to get interviews
And you weren't being successful. Well,
no, what they did was to get the Minister of Labour and an entourage. They went inside there and they were, you know, they just, everything
PR,
was covered up.
PR.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Perfect PR. Mm-hmm. So it was covered. And the ladies were saying, like, oh, we're fine. But behind doors, they were still complaining. Mm-hmm. So when I went there, when I went and did an interview, I had to do an interview, and the interview called for me to do a thing they called to make a bounded buttonhole.
Wow.
So when I did this bounded buttonhole, the lady said, are you sure you never used to work in the in somewhere like this? You weren't addressed? I said, no. So I got through. I was successful. I'd gone to my editor, Lloyd Williams, and mm-hmm. asked him, and he said, yes, it's a perfect idea. And so he was part of the thing. He would take me there, mm-hmm. take me to the my job. I worked for 3 nights because, you know, I'm on a night shift, and he would just drop me partway because it's not supposed to be seen. And then I'd walk in mm-hmm. with the ladies, walk into work. And then I was working, and I was observing everything that was happening at the free zone. So I was observing everything and recording. He would pick me up at nights. At nights, we would finish at just before midnight to catch the bus. Mm-hmm. So the ladies would run towards the last bus, and I would run towards Mr. Williams' car. He was there waiting for me with his hoodie on mm-hmm. so that nobody could recognize him. Mm-hmm. And I would race towards the car, went home, documented what I observed. And after 3 nights, my back started rebelling. So I said, you know, I'm not going any further.
And I've had enough information. Yes. I don't need to get anything more. You've served in various capacities. News editor of The Gleaner, news editor of The Sunday Gleaner. You've been editor for Flair, Outlook. What's your advice to aspiring journalists?
Okay. Aspiring journalists, go out there. Be fearless, but fair. Go out there. First of all, you need to go and get your training. Mm-hmm. Because what I don't like, although I went in untrained, but got training on the job and went to university, mm-hmm. get training. It's very important because the background is very, very good.
Yeah.
And then what is happening in social media, and so you will be there to make the difference. Mm-hmm. You will be there to tame social media because social media is a runaway wreck.
Yes. Yes.
So... so I'm advising them, having gotten your training, mm-hmm. you're going to be intimidated.
Yeah.
The politicians, them going to intimidate you.
Oh, my God.
The big business people, them going to intimidate you. Don't be intimidated by them.
Yeah. Yeah.
You must be fearless but fair.
Excellent.
One thing that Professor Agwe-Brown used to say to me, you can't be objective, but you must be fair. That means they must give everybody an opportunity mm-hmm. to... if you're making charges against them, give their side of the story. So you must be fair, mm-hmm. and you must be fearless, and you must take yourself out of the story.
Yeah.
If it's a new story, you have no right
being
there.
No business in there.
Yeah. So that, because right now we are seeing a blurring sometimes between a new story.
Opinion, journalism.
And opinion thing.
Yeah.
And people don't want to hear about you when it's a new story.
Yeah.
Allow me to make up my mind as to what the story is.
Give me the
about.
Facts. I'll make up my mind. Oh, amen. Phyllis, we have to go.
Amen.
It's so great talking to you. Congratulations on a stellar career.
Okay.
My darling, absolutely proud of you and the legacy that you have carved for yourself. And I think young journalists have something to look up to.
Yes, I think so.
Excellent.
I think so. But before we go, I just want to say something about my book.
Sure.
Because I have published a book. Out of all of this, mm-hmm. I have published my book, and it's called I Dare You, A Climb to the Pinnacle of Journalism. Mm-hmm. It speaks about, the first part about my life, but it also talks about my 45 years in media, mm-hmm. and I think it will be a good book for emerging journalists. And I'm saying thank you to the Lord, and thank you to everybody who has contributed to it, who has helped me and pushed me along the way. Yvonne Nicholson, Lolita Tracy Long, Yvonne Nicholson, from conception to mm-hmm. what it is now.
Them all come to our Phyllis, because we're gone past with time. But thank you so much speaking with us. Make sure you get a copy of I Dare You, from Phyllis Thomas. All right, multiple award-winning journalist, Phyllis
so
Thomas. Don't go anywhere. More and smile. Listen, come.